the healing is definitely promised in the Bible. It's documented. And here tonight, just like last week, we did the teaching part one. This is part two of the same teaching. But really, it's all about how to be healed, because many people don't know how to be healed. They're taught in churches today that, you know, healing died with the apostles. You know, you've come too late to tell me that you can't get a miracle. You've come too late to tell me you can't be healed. You just come too late to tell me. Why? Because I've been healed. I've been healed myself, and I'm going to tell you about that in a minute. I'm going to tell you how God healed me. Let's go to 1 Peter 2:24. I'm going to share two scriptures that I shared last week. Very important. Listen, we can't meditate on these scriptures enough. Very powerful. 1 Peter 2:24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. By whose stripes you were healed. You were healed, past tense. Again, please share this broadcast. Type your amens or longer comments to receive that ebook there of your choice. By whose stripes you were healed. You were healed. When were you healed? You were healed at Calvary, when Jesus hung his head, closed his eyes, and said, "It is finished." Before he went to Calvary and died, he took a beating by the Roman soldiers. The Roman soldiers beat him almost to death. He was a bloody, bloody mess. I could go into that. I could go into graphic detail, and maybe I will sometime. I won't right now. But this scripture says right here, by whose stripes you were healed. That's past tense. That's not future tense. Now get it. Peter wrote this, okay, under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. The apostle Peter wrote this. He said, by whose stripes you were healed. Okay, you were healed by the beating stripes of Jesus, the lacerations all over his back, all over his body, his rib cage, no doubt to his chest, his arms, his legs, his buttocks, maybe his neck. Who knows how intense it was? But the Bible says that he was marred like no other man. Can we get an amen there? Can we get a praise the Lord? By whose stripes you were healed. Amen. I'm glad to know that I was healed. You say, well, I don't feel good. I don't feel healed. I know that. I understand that. But it's not about how you feel. It's about what you believe. Okay, we cannot live in the realm of the five senses. The natural man lives in the realm of the five senses. Okay, we walk by faith and not by what? Sight. We walk by faith. We walk by a sixth sense. We walk according to the Spirit of God. Okay, and knowing his word. Look at Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. If you haven't shared it yet, folks, let's share this. Let's get the word out for this right here. Why? Because somebody's going to be healed on this broadcast. I would like to see as many people healed as possible tonight. It's according to your faith, according to my faith. We're going to put our faith together tonight in God's word. And the good news, we don't have to beg our Father to do anything. He is more than willing. Amen. For somebody that believes his word and has confidence in what he says. So he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are, look at that, with his stripes we are healed. Now, that's present tense. Now, Isaiah is writing this before Christ even came, before Christ was even born. Isaiah wrote this hundreds of years prior. Amen. So it says here that he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows. Now, I mentioned this last week, but it's worth mentioning again. The word griefs there that we're reading in verse 4 should have been translated sickness according to the Hebrew. All right, looking at the Hebrew, the word sickness is the purest word we could have used there. Instead of griefs, surely he hath borne our griefs. He bore our sickness and carried our sorrows. The word sorrows should have or could have been translated pain. Pain. What did he do? He carried your pain, and he bare your griefs. He carried your griefs, your sorrows, if that's the way you want to say it. But the original says your sickness and your pain. He carried them. If Jesus carried them, why do you and I have to carry them? We don't have to carry them. No, we don't have to carry them. Hallelujah. I know a God that's a healer tonight. I'm glad that he's healed my body. I'm sure if you've been serving Jesus for any length of time and you go to a church, if you go to a church that teaches this, no doubt you've been healed as well. Of course, there's a lot of churches that don't teach this. And guess what? If they don't get in the right place, if they don't get on healing grounds, like I like to say, if they don't get under some faith teaching, they're never going to get a miracle. You've got to get some faith teaching. Can you hear me? You've got to get some faith teaching under your belt. Praise the Lord. There's a lot of people, they have so much doubt built into them, and they need faith teaching after faith teaching to increase that faith to a healing level, to a miracle level. And God is able tonight to heal your body. So Peter said, you were healed. Isaiah said, we are healed. All right. Never future tense. It's not that you're going to be healed. You've got to claim the healing right now. Okay, say, well, I've got a migraine. So what you've got to do, okay, I'm hurting right now. You're not denying the pain. I'm not telling you that. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not telling you to deny the pain or to say that you don't have pain. That's not what I mean. What I mean is what you've got to do is claim your healing regardless of the pain. Claim your healing regardless of what the doctor says. Regardless of the prognosis or the diagnosis, regardless of the report, Isaiah 53, verse 1, okay? It says, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? I'm going to believe the report of the Lord. That's what I'm going to believe. Why? Because I have claimed it, and I've been healed. I know that it works. I'm going to give you my testimony, one of my testimonies right here tonight. When I was I believe I was in my mid-20s. Now, you all type that in, the 21st comment on here, amen or better, is going to get one of my free books here tonight that I'm giving away, one of three. All right. So we got the 21st comment, the 38th comment, and the 64th. So you can comment as many times. You can say amen as many times as you want to, and we're going to figure that out later. All right. But let me give you my testimony, my healing. All right. I was in my 20s. And I woke up one day and my abdomen was very swollen, so swollen. And you that know me, I'm not a big person. I've got a little bit of a gut. But when I was in my 20s, I was like a beanpole. I mean, 6'2" and probably 155 pounds, you know, so I was pretty thin, maybe not even that much, maybe 145, whatever I was. So I had a flat stomach. All right. At that time, wish I did today. Praise the Lord. Amen. But you know what happened? My stomach was so swollen. I had to loosen my belt. I had to undo the hook on my pants. When I went to work, I wore a suit. I wore a suit every day to the office. And I had to put my belt loop on the loosest one. I had pain in my abdomen, shooting pain throughout the day. I couldn't walk normal. I had to take short steps. I didn't have to, but I did because those around me, I didn't want them to notice and question me. Say, well, did you go to the doctor? No, I didn't. Say, well, you probably wasn't in that much pain. Well, I was in a good amount of pain. Maybe today, if it happened, I might have went to the doctor, but I didn't. I didn't want to go to the doctor. My faith said, I'm going to claim this healing. And a week went by, days, a week went by, 2 weeks went by, and I'm still not doing any better. I'm having pain. I'd wake up in the middle of the night with pain. My abdomen was 24/7. This went on for quite a while. What I begin to do is I begin to take these scripture verses and I begin to quote these verses. I begin to claim these verses because I knew enough about this teaching. Even at that age, I had studied enough about healing and miracles that I knew that if I set my faith in this word, that God would perform this. Amen. And that was my desire. That was my goal. You say, well, you're a little crazy. I know. in the natural, that's the way it looks. But that's what my faith was. My faith was to see a miracle in my life. I wanted God to heal me. I didn't want to go get cut on. I don't know what it was. This went on for weeks. And every day I would just be praising the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for healing my body. Thanking him for doing it. Not that he was going to do it. Thanking him for doing it because I knew that as a scripture I read, present tense and past tense. That's the way I praised him. Thank you, Lord, for healing my body. I'm healed right now. I would speak to it. Jesus said, speak to the mountain and the mountain should be removed. He said, speak to the tree and the tree would be plucked up in those teachings. I'm not going to go into that tonight. But for you that know that, I begin to do that. I begin to speak to this mountain that was in my life, this sickness, this whatever was going on. I begin to speak to this condition. In the name of Jesus, I command this to be healed. In the name of Jesus, I command the swelling to go down. In the name of Jesus, I command the symptoms to be gone. In Jesus' name. Every day, throughout the day, I would do that out loud and in my mind. Okay? With that, I was constantly praising God. I was constantly thanking the Lord. This went on for over a month, near 2 months. Okay, walking with these two little short steps that I was walking, all right, through my office. Like, again, I worked with mostly unbelievers. I didn't want anybody questioning me because then I would get ridiculed probably or criticized because sometimes unbelievers, they don't understand. And I'm not being critical about them. They just don't understand maybe the teaching, all right, that I understood, all right. And so I didn't want to take any criticism. So I just kept it to myself. Of course, my family knew about it. My church knew about it. But I didn't even go get prayer at church. I was just claiming this. I had such a desire to claim this and see the miracle of my life. And so this went on for near 2 months, and there was no physical sign of healing. I prayed one day. I said, Lord, I have done everything I know to do. Except one thing. I have claimed it. I have spoke your word. I claim that I'm healed. I believe that I'm healed right now in Jesus' name. But the symptoms, every symptom is still there, still swollen, morning and noon and night, pain, shooting pains all the time, day and night, wake me up in the middle of the night. After almost 2 months, I prayed that prayer and I said, Lord, I've done everything I know to do except for one thing. And it was church night, or maybe it was the next night was church night. I said, but next time I go to church, I said, I'm going to go and I'm going to obey James chapter 5. James chapter 5 says, let go before the elders of the church, have them anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And that word save there in the Greek is sozo, and it means to heal. It means to heal. It means to save. Amen. I hope that you all are sharing this right now. Comment and share why we want to grow this broadcast, why we want to see God do something right now. So I went to church. Okay, I went to church as I prayed and as I told the Lord, I said, I'm going to go get prayer after the pastor preaches or teaches, whatever he's going to do tonight at the end of the service, as it was common that we would do normally. At the end of the sermon, those that would want prayer, we would go up. That night, I went up. And they anointed me with oil, put a little drop of oil on my head, prayed for me. I didn't feel anything. Didn't see anything. Pain was still there, still swollen. Went home that night, went to bed, not feeling good. Almost 2 months. I don't know what's going on. I said it was a hernia. I don't know if it was a hernia. That's what I always believed it was. I really don't know for sure what it was. But you know what? I went to bed that night. Slept. I don't know if I woke up in the middle of the night. I can't remember waking up. But when I did wake up in the morning, guess what? Guess what? The swelling was gone. The pain was gone. Hallelujah. I got prayer the night before. I did the one thing I had not done. I had claimed it. I had praised God for it. I had spoke to the mountain over and over and over. And the one thing I had not done, I said, Lord, I'm going to go do it. I went and did that, and I got prayer, and that next morning I woke up, and the pain was gone. The swelling was gone. Hallelujah. Jesus healed me. When did he heal me? He didn't heal me the night before. He healed me at Calvary. I was healed already. I just had to claim it, expect it, and believe it. And God honored faith. God honored his word. So I don't know. Some months went by and no problems at all. Nothing happened. Nothing. No problems, no symptoms of any kind. I don't remember how many months it was. But I'm going back a long time, you know. That was in my 20s, so I'm going back 30 years. So I'm trying to remember. But it was some time went by, some months. And I woke up one morning. Guess what? Symptoms, pain. It was like it had never left. It was there again. It was at least 2 months. I don't know how long it was, but it was a couple months. And I went on for like this about 2 weeks. Same story. I could go through the whole thing again. Same thing. Claiming my healing. Devil, I am healed. I'm not having this. I am healed. At Calvary, I was healed, and I would speak to it. I would command it to go. Command the swelling to go in the name of Jesus. Like I said, that lasted for a couple weeks. Guess what? Woke up again one morning. Gone. Swelling is gone. Pain gone. In the name of Jesus. 30 years has passed. And guess what? I'm still healed today. Still healed by the power of God. It never came back again. What was it? I don't know. So you should have went to the doctor. I didn't. All I know is I'm healed. Hallelujah. I give him the praise. I give him the thanks. And your faith, amen, your faith will do something. Your faith will cause it to happen. Your faith will make something happen in the name of Jesus. Yes, it will. Oh, hallelujah. God said to Joshua, see, I have given into thine hands Jericho. Joshua and his men put this victory in the past tense, as God had done, and the walls of Jericho fell down. You know what? When God spoke to Joshua, he says, Jericho is yours. When they marched over to Jericho, guess what? The Jericho walls were still up. Soldiers standing out there with their bow and arrows. Who knows what they had, their weapons they had. The gates were closed. It didn't look like Jericho was theirs. It didn't look like it. But you know what? They stayed and they believed God, and they were silent, and they marched around that wall. You know the story. And on that seventh day, they marched seven times and they shouted. And when they shouted, the walls came down and God did what he said. It don't always happen immediately. That's my point. It don't always happen immediately. We could pray for you tonight and God has already healed you. God has already healed you. Now, if your faith will accept that, that healing will materialize in your body. Well, Brother Rodas, will cancer be healed? Yes, cancer can be healed too. I can go into that. I can give you a testimony. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter what it is. God can heal anything. Amen. I'm not the healer. Okay, you know that. You're not the healer. Jesus is the healer. Let me ask you a question. Or let me just put it out to you this way. You know, there was a certain man that put some money in his wife's coat, and he told her, he said, listen, I put some money in your coat. And he said, do you believe me? She said, yeah, I believe you. Think about it. Before she saw the money, she believed him. She got to thinking how she was going to spend that money. She got to thinking what she was going to buy, probably thinking, I could buy 12 pairs of shoes with that much money. I could buy this. I could buy a dress. I could buy a new outfit. I could buy some hats. There's no telling what she was thinking. She had that money in her coat just because her husband said it. She believed it. She didn't even know what it was. But she owned that money before she saw it. That was her money before she saw it. That was her money before she touched it. And that's the way we've got to be with faith. We've got to own this. We've got to own this before we feel like we own it. We've got to own this in our faith. We've got to take ownership of the miracle and say, it's mine. I am healed. No, you've got to get rid of the future tense. You've got to get rid of the, I am going to be healed. Mm-mm, that's not the way it works. Why? Because when you put it in the future tense, you're always pushing it out in front of you. You're pushing the miracle out in front of you. You got to own it now in Jesus' name. I own this. I may not feel good, but I own it. I may not feel healed, but I am healed because the word says it. If you can't say it within yourself, just quote the scripture. By his stripes, I am healed. By his stripes, I was healed. You can quote that and be honest. Why? Because the word cannot lie. The word cannot lie. Hallelujah. I'm glad. Why is it we have a hard time believing? You know, if your spouse put $100 in your coat, the same thing happened. Hey, I put some money in your coat, put $100. And they told you, would you believe it? Sure, you'd believe it. They blessed you with $100. You'd believe it and you'd be planning on where you was going to spend. Why can't we believe God's word like that? Why can't we be just so simple with God's word? You know, so many people, so many Christians today, so many believers have a Thomas faith. I need somebody to comment here and give us some amens and praise the Lord. Share this broadcast. If you believe what I'm saying, share this broadcast right now. You could share it more than once. Let it go out. People get on and off Facebook. Amen. Because I want to tell you about Thomas faith. You know, Thomas, he was an apostle. Jesus chose him with the other 11. He sat under the teachings of Jesus. Man, they no doubt slept together. They ate together. They ran together. They healed the sick together. They climbed the mountain together and prayed together. They talked together. They did all these things for 3 years. But Thomas had some doubt. He just couldn't get over for a while. I would hope he finally did. I would hope he finally did. But when Jesus resurrected, he'd heard about it. He hadn't seen Jesus yet. And Thomas said, I will not believe until I can put my fingers in the nail prints in his hands. I'm not going to believe he's risen from the dead until I can thrust my hand into his side. See, what the kind of faith Thomas had was, I'll believe it when I see it. And that's where many people are today. I'll believe it when I see it. I'll believe it when I see it. I'll believe it when I see it. Is that the kind of faith you have? That's not the kind of faith that's going to get you a healing. But you've got to believe it before you see it. See, Thomas didn't have that. He said, if I can see, if I can touch, I can believe. Jesus said to him, Thomas, blessed are you that you see and you believe. That's good, Thomas, but more blessed are they that believe not or see not yet believe. Wow. More blessed are they that see not yet believe. If you can believe when your senses, your five senses, your sight, you're feeling bad, when your body tells you there's sickness, and you can believe the word of God that says, I'm healed anyway. I'm healed, and this pain's going to stop. The symptoms have to go. Why? Because I'm healed. The headaches have to stop. Why? Because I'm healed. That's right. So you can believe. You know, there's a verse in Hebrews 11:6 talks about faith. Faith is the substance in verse 1 and verse 6. The whole chapter is a chapter of faith. But we read that, when we read that that word faith, and we study that word faith, it really brings out something. But let me ask you a question. Let me give you another example. I'm just trying to maybe give you a story or two that might help you believe, raise your faith levels, okay? What if somebody deeded you a home? What if you got certified mail, mailman knocked on your door, and he's got some mail? You got to sign for this, sir. You got to sign for this, ma'am. And okay, well, what is it? Well, it's a letter. And inside that, you open it up, and somebody maybe that you know has sent you the title deed of their home. They signed the house over to you, the house you never saw, a house you never saw. And so they signed it over. The house is paid off. Insurance is paid for a year. Taxes is paid for a year. And they sent you the title deed. Title, the house could be across the town, could be across the state, or on the other side of the country. Regardless, you never saw the house, but you've got the title deed. Now, you see your name on the title deed. You see it's a certified copy. You see it's authentic. Let me ask you, are you going to believe it? It might be hard to believe at first because it never happened to you. And that's like healing. Some people have never been healed. And that first time of getting healed is a little difficult for some people. It shouldn't be. We just need to believe God's word. We just need to believe God's word. Well, you know, when you've got that title deed, you know what the Greek word for faith, the Greek word explains faith as a title deed. Actually, in the Greek lexicon, when you look it up, there in Hebrews chapter 6, it gives the connotation of a title deed. In other words, your faith is the title deed for the thing you're believing for. That person that received that title for the house, all right, somebody gives you a car. Well, they don't give you the car itself, but they give you the title to the car. A nice car. They hand it to you and say, here, I want you to have my car. Come tomorrow and pick it up. You know where I live. Be at my house tomorrow. I'll be home all day. Just stop by and pick it up. But here's the title. When they gave you that title and they signed that title over to you, you took ownership of that. That is your faith. Your faith is the title deed. It's the title deed to whatever you need from God. Okay, Jesus said, ask and it shall be given. You seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Now, some of you may have played the lottery, you know, in the past. Might be some of you playing it right now. Amen. I want you to make some comments there. Give us some amens. Look at Sister Lomax there. She's going to get that book. Praise the Lord. 21st comment's going to get a free book of your choice. And the 38th comment is also going to get another book. I've got three to give away, three different books. So one person might win them all. All right. And if there's 64 comments, the 64th comment is going to get a book. That person's going to get a book as well. So just comment, praise the Lord. And we're going to make this thing go viral. We want to share this. Why? We want to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Yes, we do. So for you that play the lottery, how many times did you lose? I'd see my dad, he used to play sometimes when I was young. He'd win $20, $10, you know. And he'd go turn it back in and buy some more tickets, try to win a big one. I think he won a few hundred dollars one time, once or twice. But let me ask you a question. If the ticket you bought says that you won, numbers matched or scratch off or whatever it is, I don't know what they do nowadays. I know they used to have numbers and scratch offs. But if that ticket says that you won $1 million, or if that ticket said you won $100,000, and you looked at it and you looked at it, you had somebody else look at it, if it said it, wouldn't you believe it? I know those people start jumping and shouting. They're going crazy. They call their attorneys. They get everything lined up. Why? Because they just won $10 million, $20 million. Why? Because they've got the matching number. They've got the numbers side by side. They've stared at it for hours. They believe it. Listen, if we could stare at this word for hours, and if we can believe it, something that looks impossible can take place. Something that looks impossible. Something that cannot happen naturally. Nothing too hard for the Lord. There was a woman in the Bible. The scripture says that she had an issue of blood. I believe it was 12 years or 14 years, whatever it was. And the Bible says she spent all that she had on doctors. You know, we can do that today. Our insurance, people's insurance. I've heard of people's insurance, health insurance, running out of benefit because they've spent so much on doctors. And that's what happened with her. She didn't have insurance, of course, but she spent all she had, but she grew worse. Had an issue of blood, a blood flow. For 12 years, she heard about Jesus. She heard of the miracles. She heard of a commotion outside. She heard of the crowd. She saw the tears. She saw the excitement. She saw the joy. She saw the leaping and the jumping and the happiness. Tears of joy. And the Bible says that she said within herself, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. If I can touch the hem of his garment. That woman, no doubt she was weak. No doubt she was very sick for 12 years losing blood. But you know what? She made up her mind. If I can touch Jesus today, he's out there in the street. I'm going to go to where he is. And she went out there and she pressed through the crowd. She pressed through the crowd in Jesus' name. and she touched the hem of his garment. Jesus stopped. Whatever he was doing, he stopped. He said, who touched me? Looked around to his disciples and said, who touched me? The disciples says, Lord, the multitude is touching. They were all around him, touching him, trying to get a miracle. So you can touch Jesus, but you got to believe when you touch him. And this woman with the issue of blood, she believed when she touched him. You can touch him, but you've got to believe. You got to have faith when you touch him, that right now I'm receiving my miracle. That was her. That was her release. Her touching him was her release. I heard of a preacher. He was talking about when he was young and he was praying to receive the Holy Ghost. And he said, he made up his mind. He was in that altar praying. He wanted to receive the Holy Ghost. And he said to himself, the next preacher that lays hands on me, I'm going to receive the Holy Ghost. Oh my. And that was his faith for that night. And there was a preacher that walked by and put his hands on his head and began to pray for him. And he began speaking with tongues as the Spirit of God gave him the utterance. He received the Holy Ghost that night. Why? Because he set his faith. He set his faith that night. Amen. I did something similar when I received the Holy Ghost. I was 17 years old. Sunday morning church service. I didn't even know about that man at that time. I didn't even know him. But that Sunday morning service, the pastor said, we're going to have a great church service tonight. Be back at 7 o'clock. He said, who in here is going to receive the Holy Ghost tonight? He was just wanting somebody to respond in faith. And I put my hand up because I had not received it, but I wanted it. Well, that day I was believing God, tonight is my night. And guess what? That night on March 2nd, 1980, I received that wonderful experience of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I did. Praise the Lord. Awesome. So we've got this woman with the issue of blood. And Jesus said, thy faith has made you whole. It wasn't the prayer. It wasn't a certain conglomeration of words that was put together. But it was a simple faith that this woman had. Now look at the 10 lepers in the Bible. Jesus talked about the 10 lepers. The 10 lepers, they came to Jesus and Jesus said to them, go your way and show yourself to the priest. And as you go, you are healed. And the 10 lepers left. They were on their way to show themselves to the priest. So the priest could offer a sacrifice for their healing. Now, no doubt they had fingers missing because of the leprosy, sores, just terrible looking men. But Jesus said, go your way. Your faith has made you whole. There was one man that turned around and began to praise the Lord. They were all healed. But Jesus said to that one man, thy faith has made you whole. His fingers that were gone were restored. His toes that were gone from the leprosy that were ate away, and the sores that were still visible, it all disappeared instantly. He was made whole instantly. Why? Because of his faith. Your faith is so powerful. Your faith is so strong. Hallelujah. It says in Acts 10:38, if you want to turn there, Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that was oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. God was with him. You know what? Sickness is an oppression. Sickness definitely is an oppression. Jesus said it was. I don't like sickness. I don't like sickness. I don't like disease, and I know that you don't. But sickness is an oppression. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Hallelujah. Well, in Mark chapter 16, verses 17 and 18. If you want to read there with me, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Jesus said, these signs shall follow them that believe. These signs shall follow them that believe. Oh, follow who? Follow the preacher. The signs shall follow the preacher. Amen. I'm glad that signs still follow the preacher. The signs still follow the believer. But the preacher's got to be a believer too. There are some preachers that are not believers. Amen. There are preachers that would so disagree with me tonight. They would so disagree with me and say, this all died out with the apostles. It's not happening. I'm telling you tonight that this is true. This is true. But you, it's not just for the preacher. It's for anybody. I don't care who you are. You may be the most unrecognized person in the church, but if you're a believer, you can lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Amen. You could pray for your grandchildren. You could pray for your children. And the fevers can go. The sickness can go. Through your prayer and through your faith, you can believe for them. Sometimes they may not have faith, and you can believe for them. And their faith may heal them sometime. But your faith is so powerful. It's not the prayer that does it, but it's the faith that does it. Amen. Joshua spoke to the sun in the writings of the book of Joshua. The Bible says that when he was in a battle, he looked up and said, "Sun, stand up. Sun, stand thou still. Sun, don't move. Moon, stay where you're at over the valley." And by the space of, I believe it was a day and a half, the Bible says that the sun and the moon did not move. The whole universe stopped because he spoke and he believed. What about you tonight? What about you? Even the people in the days of the apostles, they believed the apostles so much so. They believed the word that was spoken, where Peter could walk down the street and they could lay the sick and the diseased out in the street at a certain angle where the sun was, and so that the shadow of Peter would touch them. And the Bible says they were healed. There was no anointing in the shadow, but maybe they couldn't get to him, whatever the case was, but they believed so much when his shadow touched them, they were healed. Even Paul, the apostle, he gave out handkerchiefs and aprons. The Bible says from his body, and people were healed. When he would send it out to someone, and a sick person maybe days later would receive that handkerchief or that apron, and they would be healed. Why? Because somebody believed. Somebody released their faith. It's so simple. Amen. And that's my job. My job is to make it simple. And that's what I'm trying to do tonight. Because if I can, I'm going to help you believe. And I'm going to put my faith with you. Amen. If you've got a prayer request tonight, we'll take that. There was a lady some years ago. We were in a church service, and we were ministering faith and healing. And she came up for prayer. I didn't know what she came up for prayer for. And there were other people praying and getting prayer. And all of a sudden, this woman, she was done. She went back to her seat. Several minutes later, this woman got excited. I mean, she got excited in her seat. She was like the second row from the front. And there in her seat, I didn't know her. I'd never met her before. But she began to dance and to shout and raise her voice in praise. And she kind of got attention a little bit, because what was going on with her? Well, so I asked her. I just asked to calm the crowd down a little bit. I says, "Sister, what's going on with you? Can you tell me, do you have a testimony?" Because I know she had just got prayer. And she said, "Yes, I got prayer, as you know." And she said, "I had a cyst on my foot. The cyst was between my toes, and I was supposed to have a surgery to have it removed. I just took my shoe off, and I looked, and the cyst is gone. God has removed the cyst from my foot." God had instantly removed that. Now, I saw that happen. I saw that. I don't, if you're a believer and you're used to this, you know these things happen. Amen. And this is the beauty of it. There was a sister in our church several years back. I believe her name was Chantrice, I believe is her name, if I'm pronouncing that right. And boy, she was a singer. She was a school teacher in Illinois, and she taught music, and she taught singing and all that in the school there. And she was very good. She'd been in church all of her life, had a beautiful voice, and used of the Lord in that area. But she came to church one Sunday, her and her kids, and she wasn't talking. And she gave us a note, and then her son began to talk to us as well. And says, "Well, my mom can talk, but she's not talking. She was at the doctor the other day, and the doctor said, don't talk for a week, because she had a cyst, I believe it was a cyst or a tumor, something was on her vocal cords, because she had had a raspy voice as of lately and didn't know why her voice was changing, and she was very concerned about it. So she went to the doctor, and the doctor had done, done a test, that looked at it, said, I don't want you to talk for a week. I want you to rest your voice. No singing, no talking at all. So it'd been several days since she had been to the doctor. And he told her, but as well, we're going to have to remove that by surgery. We can remove that with a simple surgery, but I want you to rest. I want you to rest first. And so then we can go in and take care of that. And so she did. For several days, she had not talked. Well, she came to church at the end of the church service. She wanted us to pray for her, and the church gathered around. The church began to pray for her. Amen. And well, we said our goodbyes. She gave her wave or whatever she did, shook hands. She didn't say anything. She left. And we got word back. I don't remember if she called us or what she did, but we got word back that when she got in the car with her son, he was a teenager, she just decided she was going to go ahead and talk. Like I said, she could talk. She just, under doctor's orders, she hadn't talked in several days, but she just believed God. She decided she was going to go ahead and talk. And she did. She started talking to her son about whatever. And he said, Mom, your voice sounds like the voice of a girl. It sounds so good. And she went back to the doctor, and the doctor re-looked at her and examined her for that cyst that was on her vocal cords that she was going to have surgery for. And the doctor says, that cyst, I can't find it. I don't know what's going on, but I know I have, that cyst was there. And she said, I know what happened. God healed me. And she testified to that doctor, that cyst was gone. God removed that thing, amen, by a surgery in that Sunday church service. Praise the Lord. God can do it. Church, God can do it. My wife was healed of a fibroid tumor. She went in to have a little procedure to have that done. The doctor, they had given us a sheet of paper with the measurements of that fibroid tumor that was on her uterus, having complications and symptoms. Doctor says, I'm going to have to remove, to stop all this from happening. And so she went in for the surgery. Well, that was on a Monday. I believe it was a Monday. But that Sunday, we had a healing service at church, and I preached on healing, and we prayed for her. The church gathered around and prayed for her, and she went in there and had that surgery. And I'm sitting out there an hour, hour and a half, 2 hours, what it was, in the waiting room there by myself. And finally, the doctor came out and sat down by me, and she said, well, everything went good, and she'll probably be resting for about an hour and a half, and then she can go home, just talking like that. But everything's good, and she'll be fine now. She didn't mention nothing about the tumor, nothing. And like I said, I got this piece of paper that shows the size. They had the dimensions on it, right? She gave that to my wife before the surgery. And I said to the doctor, because she hadn't brought it up, I says, well, what about the tumor? Did you remove it? She said, there was no tumor. That's all she said. There was no tumor. I said, there was no tumor? She said, no. I was bumfuzzled. I didn't know what to say. I was like, she let me go in there in a few minutes and talk to my wife, and my wife was half out of it. And I bent over and the doctor said there was no tumor. And my wife started crying. The tears was just streaming down her face, the sides of her face, because she knew that God had healed her. The doctor went in there, but there was no tumor to remove. My God is able. Amen. He's looking for a believer. You could pray all night long and not believe. But if you can pray one time and believe, one simple prayer and believe, there's nothing too hard for you. Amen. Nothing too hard for you. I'm going to give you this right here. And if there's anybody that wants prayer, we're going to take maybe one or two calls here. We're going to give out a phone number here in just a moment. I've got a special call in line for you. But I'm going to give you the difference between a miracle and a healing. Now, no doubt that was a miracle healing that my wife received. It was gone. The woman that had the cyst between her foot, that was a miraculous healing. But sometimes we get healed, and it's not always instant. You know what I mean? It's not always like that. I heard of a man that was deaf in one ear, and they prayed for him. I wasn't there. And went home that night, went to bed. He woke up the next morning. And he was healed in that ear. He could hear 100% in that ear. Well, it manifested overnight. There are some people that get better day by day, and over a progression of days, sometimes weeks, even serious health conditions, the condition dwindles down to zero, and it's gone like that. And sometimes this is the reason why many people lose their healing. They get prayer at church, or even in a setting like this, I can pray for you, or somebody else can lay hands or agree with you in prayer. But if you don't take ownership right now, regardless of the symptoms, when we're done praying, you've got to take ownership and say, I am healed. Again, not I am healed or I'm going to be healed. No, the future tense has got to, you got to get rid of that future tense. I am healed, or I was healed at Calvary. That's the way you've got to believe it. I am healed. All right. When you can believe that, it will manifest in Jesus' name. You claim it. Don't waver in your faith. It'll come to pass. All right. So you could get a miracle healing, instant, immediate results. Pain disappears. All right. We've seen headaches disappear instantly just through prayer. I've seen it a number of times. Other conditions. I could go through more. I'm not going to. We've been on here for an hour, almost an hour right now. But we're going to open up the prayer line for any of you that want prayer. I'm going to give you this number, and we're going to take maybe one or two calls. And if you've got a condition in your body right now, you can give us a call. We're going to pray about that. The number is area code 219-315-0551. That's 219-315-0551. Now, if there is no one that needs prayer, that's wonderful. But if there is, we're more than glad to pray with you. And we're going to speak against that condition, and we're going to believe God with you. Amen. Right now, if there's anybody that wants to call in live right now, 219-315-0551. If you've not shared this broadcast, please do so. If you're watching on YouTube, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. Amen. God is able right now. We're going to give it another minute. Amen. If there's anybody that wants to call in for prayer, 219-315-0551. Hallelujah. God is able. God is able. Nothing too hard for the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Well, let's pray right now. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful for this time, this word tonight that is so powerful and rich in our spirit. The word of the Lord is so precious. The truth of your word tonight, God, that still goes forth and heals the sick. Oh, God, miraculous healings, deliverances, people delivered of evil spirits, people delivered of cancers and tumors and cysts and polyps, and Lord, all kinds of conditions. Lord, we thank you for your miracle working power on this night. We give you the praise in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. I do want to say if there's 21 comments on there, that 21st comment, we'll be notifying you. And if you know that you're the 21st comment, be sure, and we're going to let you choose one of those three books, and we'll send that over to you. I will need your email address. You can inbox that to me, inbox here on Facebook. If there's 30 comments, that person as well, maybe the same person, I don't know. And the 64th comment, if there's that many comments on here tonight, we're going to award you and bless you with an ebook, one of those ebooks there you can see on my page that I posted just a little while ago. I posted them all on one. And like I said, if you're the 21st commenter, 38th, or the 64th person commenting, we're going to bless you with a book. We're so glad you joined with us tonight on this time. Again, share this. Give us a thumbs up there for YouTube and subscribe to this channel. Until next time, God bless you in Jesus' name.